Hello. Oh, you're on mute.
Hi, how are you?
Good, good. I'm well.
That's
my
good.
Name's Katrina. I've been emailing and doing various things. How are you?
I'm well, thank you. How are you?
Good, good. Well, you know, being a mum and being
busy.
Yes. Giving my husband directions on the lasagna that's in the oven and when it'll be just right and when to, you know, so he'll be in charge of serving it up. But yeah, we're all good.
That's good.
Yes. How's your day been?
Good. My son is going to kindergarten next year. So we had an orientation session for him in the morning, and then I took him to childcare, did some work, made some dinner. We had early dinner because I was like, oh, I want to get this out of the way. and here I am.
Excellent. We are so pleased that you could come and join us through the magic of Zoom, which has been one of the things that I think we did more with during the pandemic. I think I think we realized that we could do so much and do lots of international meetings and all kinds of different things.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think it's been great to be able to do things instead of the in-person events and have these online spaces. And sometimes it actually, you know, it has a lot of benefits. Like you can fit more in, you can, you know, invite more people, you can make it more accessible. So it can be a good thing.
I always like in-person things because I think you just get such a sense, particularly when you're getting together with activists.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we all give each other so much energy.
Yeah.
People come out. Whether I'm giving a talk or on a panel or just turning up to something else, you know, you just, everyone gives each other energy, which I think, it's not quite the same over Zoom, but
I agree.
I'll just sort of very quickly, while it's just us, you know, we'll have a bit of a chat if that's all right.
Sure.
I didn't know your story. I live in Melbourne and I didn't know your story. So I was searching for somebody that I thought would be really interesting to come along to this event.
Mm-hmm.
Because our little group, this is an event for the 16 days of activism against gender-based violence. And I found you and your story and your book. I particularly wanted someone who'd written a book and that kind of thing. And then when I read that your mum, because I've read your book, your mum had written or had done some posts, I think, about the 16 days of activism, I thought, wow, that's so interconnected. So I was so pleased to find your book and to find your story. And I'm really excited that we, as our little group here in Melbourne, can hear from somebody who we might not get to hear from. You know, it's that was what I was aiming for. I wanted to hear voices of people that we might not always get to hear from.
Mm-hmm.
We do events like Amnesty International, you know, the world's largest human rights organization. We have 10 million members worldwide, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I'm the convener of our local group here, sort of in Eltham, which is we have about 7 or 8 regular members and then a list of about 160 people. You know, we're a fairly small little thing, but
mm-hmm.
Amnesty obviously is a global
mm-hmm.
organization and people have heard of us. I also have been the Victorian president for Amnesty, so I've worked that. And now I'm on a subcommittee of our national board. And occasionally I get to do some international work, which is really exciting. So connecting with people, other Amnesty people around the world, like that. Mm-hmm. So, but what this was about was we in the past haven't done something for the 16 days of gender-based violence, but I saw our local council were doing some things and I thought, no, this is something you know, women's rights to human rights.
Yep.
So that was sort of the inspiration. And then I started looking around, and Mira, who's the owner of the bookshop, Elfin Bookshop, you know, she's very passionate about all sorts of different topics, and is very good at getting lots of different authors
mm-hmm.
to come along to events and all kinds of things. So that's how it all sort of started to come together.
Perfect.
Yeah, so no, and your book was amazing. I mean, really well written.
Thank you.
Beautifully written. And obviously there's a lot of really confronting topics that you cover. But one of the things that I really liked as well was your descriptions of when you went to Lebanon when you were a child. And talking about, because I have Lebanese friends, Australian Lebanese friends, but I've never been to Lebanon. So your descriptions of, you know, running around your grandma's house, or, you know, your cousins, and what the countryside looked like and all of that, I really liked all of that as well. So
thank you. It was a joy to write those bits and to go back through to go back through some old photos and revive those memories and document it all. I think was actually one of the really satisfying and rewarding parts of the writing process, definitely. Yeah. So I'm glad a few people have said that they've enjoyed those sort of scenic parts of the book. So that's really, it's really nice that people have connected with that, and it's taken them to a place that they haven't been able to go physically.
So it just, you know, gives me a sense of what you know, going there, because you went for months. It wasn't just a weekend or anything, like I might go to my grandparents' farm. It was, sort of that longer time and all the fun things that you did as kids, and it was carefree and all of that. That was, really lovely. I really enjoyed those sorts of things. I've not done the sort of asking the questions, being the host type person. I'm often the one that's giving a speech or being on a panel myself. Mm-hmm. So I'm not, you know, very polished, and I'm not Lee Sales.
No, that's okay. I couldn't get an interview with Lee Sales, actually.
Look, I'll be on to her, and I really think I was actually thinking that. I think she really should be interviewing you. I'm a big fan of Lee Sales and her podcast and, you know, all the silly things they do. But no, I will be strongly advocating that she does get one. So I thought, if it's all right, what I was thinking, because this is sort of a conversation, is sort of I put together some themes that, so I thought if you would like, I'm happy to sort of read through them and just see, you know, how you feel about them. You can say, no, I don't want to talk about that, or you know, different things. These are just some things. As I was reading your book, I was sort of taking a few notes and sort of thinking, that would be a good, that's sort of a theme thing and that sort of stuff. So, got my glasses on. So my first question was, what significance does the title, The Mother Wound, have for you, and why did you decide on the title?
Okay.
That would be a nice one. In your book, you discuss feminism and women of colour. So, and you ask yourself, what can contemporary feminism do for me? So what were your thoughts on that?
Mm-hmm.
You discuss intersectionality. You're a survivor of family violence, a Muslim Arab woman who's a mother. How do you feel all those things sort of intersect? You discuss being not the good kind of victim, which I found really interesting. And I get exactly what you're saying there. And can you explain what that means to you?
Mm-hmm.
You discussed the concept of forgiveness, and many people were demanding that you forgive your father for his crimes. What were your thoughts on that? You say in the book, we need to do more than just talk about ending violence against women. What would you like us to know about how we can affect change?
Yep.
And you were shortlisted for the Archibald Prize for your paintings. How has art helped you heal from trauma? So those okay. are just some. Is there anything there that you'd rather not discuss? Or
no, I think they're all pretty. Yeah, there's some of the prominent themes that are in the book, so I'm comfortable with all of that. Okay. Yeah, happy to speak to those things.
Great. I was trying to also. I mean, when we talk about women's rights and things like that, feminism is a strong theme, but I like the idea of hearing from you about, and I really got, and I thought really interesting how you were saying, well, this sort of mainstream kind of Anglo-feminism, how do I fit into that? Is that talking to me or not? And I find that interesting. So I'm hoping other people will find all of that.
Yeah, yeah. I think it is interesting. And I think it's an important conversation that people are having now, especially with like online influencers and how feminism gets used as a bit of a brand. And I think it's a really, yeah, really interesting and relevant point.
Yeah. And what the plan is that we'll ask people to write their questions. So we hope to have a little question and answer time.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll ask people to put things in the chat and sort of hopefully I'll be able to do that quite quickly and sort of manage it all.
Yep.
And ask you, but I'll be kind of vetting the question. So, and Amnesty in Australia, we have policies on, and I'll sort of say, look, if there are any, if I feel that there's anything, you know, inappropriate language, I'll find what I've written so I can, yes, if we won't tolerate any inappropriate questions or comments,
mm-hmm.
and that this is to be a safe space and all those sorts of things.
Okay.
You know, it doesn't happen often, and I'm really sure it won't happen tonight because I know most people who are coming.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, we've as an organisation decided that sort of thing won't be tolerated, particularly when people like you give your time to us to do this sort of thing. So,
mm-hmm.
And if there's any questions that you don't want to answer or you just let me know or something along that line, very happy to be guided by what you would like to talk. Basically, it's what you would like to tell us sort of thing, because there are so many things that we could talk about. We could talk about for 4 hours, I'm sure.
Yeah.
But we'll try and keep it to time. I'll try and keep a good eye on the time and things like that.
So. Okay, sounds good. I really appreciate that. I think I haven't had any issues in the past, but we, you know, it's good to have those zero tolerance policies in place. Yeah.
Yeah. Very occasionally Amnesty might have an event and, you know, somebody might come along who has a certain point of view that they're quite, you know, they're wanting to express and, you know, and they've been told that, you know, so there's a couple of people that have said, well, you're not welcome to our online events anymore.
Mm-hmm.
You just haven't listened when we've said, you know, that's inappropriate or those sorts of things. So we definitely want to make sure that anyone who comes to our events feels comfortable and that sort of thing. Was there anything you wanted to ask me about or?
No, they're just some general housekeeping. Usually, in an introduction, it's good to sort of flag that it's going to include a direct conversation about domestic abuse and violence, and for people to feel comfortable having a break or exercising self-care, whatever that looks like for them. And I don't know if you have a list of some phone numbers like 1-800-RESPECT or anything like that you can post in the chat. I'll just grab some.
Oh, okay.
If I can just, I'll try and find some on a website. So there's a list on the government website. If I can, perhaps the simplest way to do it is to recommend 1-800-RESPECT.
Yeah.
I'll just copy and paste the information for you right now in the chat, and then you can copy it from your end and then repost it in the chat, maybe towards the end of the conversation, because apparently people can't see the chat if you, so when someone enters the conversation, they can only see what they've been there for, not what's been posted beforehand.
Oh, okay. Yep.
So that's,
so if I just,
hold on, that's the info. I've just popped that in the chat.
So if I just copy and paste that, put it into, I've got a document with a couple of other things.
Yep.
And then I can just redo it, hopefully. I'm not super great at this sort of stuff. I've been learning. I'm sort of an age where, you know.
That's okay. I think that that one is useful. There are also state phone numbers, but that one is a referrals line, so it should be a good starting point for anyone who feels triggered or feels like it's brought up an issue for them and they want to talk to someone or pursue further, you know, safety planning or whatever they need. So that's, I think that's important to include. So usually I kind of have a little spiel where I say, you know, this is going to include a conversation around this, but if you want to do that in the introduction, that's, you know, very welcome. Apart from that, oh, just that I can't give personal advice to anyone, because sometimes people feel these things come up and they want to ask questions that are very specific to a specific situation, or they start typing it in the chat. And that's like, you know, I can't really help with that. So maybe in you know, sharing that phone number, maybe a sentence to add is that we can't provide you with advice for your specific situation, but if this conversation has brought up any issues for you, please contact 1-800-RESPECT.
Hopefully I can do all of that. My technical skills aren't super, but hopefully I can. Might take me a couple of minutes, but I think I can do that.
That's okay. Yeah, if I don't see it pop up in the chat or anything like that, I'll just post it in the end, towards the end, just to, like, you know, supplement the information. But it should be fine. Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Well, that all sounds good. Yes, we should be, I think Mira's going to be joining. Mira will do the introduction, and then I'll do the acknowledgement of country and those sorts of things, and then we'll sort of kind of move on. I will try really hard to stick to time, but sometimes conversations get so interesting, but we will definitely finish on time. This is what we have, because obviously you'll need to be sorting out small children and various things.
Yes. So the only other thing that just came to mind was, will there be a Q&A at the end?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Yep. All right. Yep. Yes, easy.
So we'll do a bit of a conversation, and then there'll be, you know, maybe 15 minutes or something for the Q&A, but we'll do it through the chat so that people aren't. And it might be that we've covered sort of a few topics and people feel, that's answered what I was thinking or whatever. Other people might have. There are so many different topics, obviously, that we could cover and that sort of thing. So how often would you get asked to sort of speak at various events and things now?
In the 16 days of action, that's probably the busiest part of the year, or the 16 days of activism, I've got, I don't, I try to avoid it, but last week I had three back to back. And some of them are presentation style, so I'll have PowerPoints and it'll be more like delivering information and reflections that include my personal story. And then other events have been really book related, and it's more speaking about the writing and the book, and you know, my, with my hat as a writer on. And it's a, it's really a mix of those things. So the, these 2 weeks are generally the busiest, and then there's also a couple of busy weeks around International Women's Day each year.
Yeah.
And then scattered throughout the year.
Yeah.
But this time of the year is usually where it really ramps up. And yeah, a lot of, I mean, which is great, you know, but I try to space it out so I get some rest in between.
Yeah. I know the feeling. I'm a volunteer with Amnesty. Mm-hmm. But I've been an activist with Amnesty for 20 years. So I've done all sorts of different things over, and it just seems that all kinds of different things happen all at the same time. You know, you have all these events, and, you know, I'm trying to, well, I've moved house, and we've, you know, all kinds of different things all happening. There's Mira. Hello, Mira. You're on.
We can't hear you.
Is that better?
Yes, much better.
Thank you. Hello, how are you?
I'm well, thank you. How are you?
And congratulations on this wonderful book.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
So it's been quite a, how long did it take you to write it?
Oh, big journey. I would say 2 years, but about a year of that, it was my full-time job. But I've got two small children, and we went through COVID and lockdown and things like that. So it wasn't linear. It was very up and down.
Now, so very well done. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Yeah. Very glad to have got it out. It's a good feeling. Yeah.
That's right. So I'm fine now. I'm just getting a bit of reassurance about Zoom and things. I'm not very technologically.
That's okay.
I've done a few over COVID with the bookshop, but it's always daunting to just know all the things will work. But I'm glad Katrina's taking charge today. So.
Well, you know, I'm going to try my best to sort of post different things, and I've got some different websites and different things that, so hopefully, fingers crossed, I can make it work. But our Amnesty staff set up the Zoom, so I've used their login, so I have access to more things. Usually if you're not the host, it's harder to, but because they had the better Zoom connections and various things.
You also have better timing, because I think we are limited to about half an hour with our account.
Yes.
So we've been very, very quick about our Zoom things. But they've been good. You know, it's been, I spoke to Javit Elam in Canada. He's the man who escaped from Manus.
Mm-hmm. I was at that one, I think. Yes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That was very interesting. You know, I could see the dawn creeping in Toronto through his window.
Yeah. We were just saying that we will try and make sure that we talk about the fact that there will be issues and things talked about that could be triggering for people, so that if they need to have a break, or you know, we're going to put in the 1-800 respect, things like that. So when you've done your introduction, Mira, I might mention those sorts of things you would like.
Perfect. Yeah, that's a good idea. Very, very sensible thing to do. Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
Hi, Carol. Carol's one of our Amnesty. Amnesty people from Newcastle in Sydney.
Hello, everyone.
Sorry. Yes.
Good to see you.
Yes.
Yeah.
Nice to be here. I'm really looking forward to this.
Thank you.
Yeah, I spoke to a few people at the bookshop today, and they were quite interested because, you know, we've just opened up, and I can only get my customers about now. And there were 60 boxes to receive today. So your book was, you know, right up with a big pile there. So I was talking about it. So we don't know if people might just link in today, but we'll see.
Yeah. And will it be recorded? Are we already recording? Yep.
Yes,
okay. Yep.
I think we're recording.
Okay. Good. Yeah.
Yes, I think it is recording.
Yeah. It is. I can see the light now.
So Mira, you were saying that you were thinking that you put this on your YouTube channel, is that right?
Yes, after I get the recording, we'll just edit the little bits that we've been speaking about and just tape it and put it in, and I'll share it, yes.
Okay, so Mira was saying she's got about 2,000 people that have access to that, which is fantastic. So that was one of the things that we were hoping that we could, you know, make sure lots of people get to see this conversation. Hello, great. Melissa. Melissa is somebody from our local Amnesty group.
It's nice to virtually meet you.
You too. I'm excited. I was looking forward to this all day, actually.
So I think there'll be a few more people join us. And I think you've had a bit of rain up your way, yeah?
Yeah, we're having really bad weather for this time of year at the moment. We've had rain. We had a couple of days where it was freezing cold.
Oh.
Yeah, and today's a muggy. It hasn't rained, but it's been threatening to all day. So it's not pleasant springtime weather, but oh well.
Yes. I think Carol was, you've had floods up near Newcastle and it's
We've not been affected, but you know, they're kind of around us. And and today I just was struck by how dark it's been. It's been like almost sun going down dark all day, and it's quite eerie, really.
Yeah, it is. It makes it really hard to get up and get motivated about the things you need to do. But oh well.
Jenny's also part of our local group. So that's nice. Got all the ladies so far.
So this painting, Amina, where is it now?
The original is in my house. It's in my studio, yeah. So it's been, it hung in the Archibald Prize, and then it toured to a couple of regional galleries, and then it was part of a solo exhibition that I had on, and then it came back. It was meant to, Dimmicks were going to do a window display on George Street when my book was being launched, but because of COVID that got cancelled, so it's just come back from my publishers. It's sitting in bubble wrap. Yeah.
So they haven't got a print or anything like that, have they? Or you're not allowed to make prints?
No, I've never made a print of that. The Art Gallery of New South Wales sells it as a postcard. So I've seen those around, but I've never made prints of it. Yeah.
I might have to tap them on their shoulder because I think it's amazing. And I'm wondering why I didn't go on the cover, but maybe that was not allowed either.
I didn't ask, and I guess I just the cover designer, Akiko, just wonderful. Was able to do her thing. Yeah, and it was so striking and beautiful that it, you know, there's nothing to complain about. She just did a beautiful job. Yeah.
I guess that was an easy way out. So signal to me when we're ready, Katrina, when you think everybody's in.
I think we might make a start. There might be a couple of more people sort of come in, but we might make a start. And so take it away, Mira.
Well, good evening, everybody, and thank you very much for joining us on this evening. It's very balmy here, but I'm sure wherever you are, you'd be in very happy circumstances without the masks anyway. I want to acknowledge the Wurundjeri elders from whose land I'm speaking, and acknowledge their elders past and present. Amani, it's a great privilege and an honor to have your book in my hand. Your book is many things. It's not just a book. It is the story, I think, of a daughter's grief at losing her mother in circumstances that many of us would not be able to imagine, you know, unimaginable conditions. It is also a manifesto, I think, written by an activist lawyer who's passionately connected to the issues of gender-related violence in society and for speaking up for the victims. I think motherhood for me also, when I read it, stands as a memorial to the 2006 war and occupation of Lebanon, and to the nature of how violence begets violence through generations because of injustice and oppression. And finally, it makes rears its head in a home. You know, people often wonder what's going on in the house, but if you trace back, it's societies that we have leveled to the ground, you know, and caused so much disruption. I also think, Amani, that you've written a book about the need for compassion and forgiveness, the need for justice, and most of all of us to speak up for victims of violence. You have written a book that I think is furious and powerful, honest, and very intimate. It's heartbreaking and very hopeful. Today I was telling people, please don't go away thinking it's a despairing book. Out of this has been born a courageous woman, a mother who's got two children now. So that's a great story of hope and courage. And you've shown that trauma and terrible stuff can actually sharpen you and can make you ready for the world. So thank you, Amani, for the gift of your beautiful book. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mira. That was a very generous and I think beautiful summary of what I set out to do with my book. So I really appreciate that. And I'm Zooming from Darugland in Western Sydney, and I pay my respect to the elders past and present whose knowledge I've drawn upon as I've embarked on this journey, and the Aboriginal women who have shared knowledge about women's health and safety in different forums that I've been a part of. And I guess I'm cognizant of the work that remains to be done in order to achieve justice on this land, and to overcome that historical trauma and the ongoing trauma that Aboriginal women are subjected to.
Okay, thank you, Mira and Amani. I would like to do an acknowledgement on our behalf. So we acknowledge the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation, which is the traditional custodians of the land where most of us are. We pay respects to their elders past, present and emerging. We say with regret and sadness that our colonisation took over their land and livelihood, tried to destroy spiritual customs and language, drove them from their country and essential identity. We recognise now that the culture is alive and continuing over 60,000 years. They remain sovereign people. Welcome everybody. Thank you for coming along tonight. I would just like to start by giving just a quick overview of the 16 days of activism against gender-based violence, which is why we've put together this interesting meeting tonight, because the 16 Days of Activism Against Gender-Based Violence is an annual international campaign that starts on the 25th of November and runs till the 10th of December, which is World Human Rights Day. It was started by activists in 1991, so it's its 30th year anniversary, and is coordinated each year by the Centre for Women's Global Leadership. It is used as an organisational strategy around the world to call for the prevention and elimination of violence against women and girls. So tonight, there's a couple of things that we'll go through. One of the things we hope, I'll ask some questions of Marnie, and we'll have a bit of a conversation, and then there'll be time at the end bit of a question and answer session. So if you'd like to put your questions in the chat, then closer to the end, then I'll go through and we'll ask. Amani, at Amnesty, so I'm the convener of our local Amnesty International group here in Eltham, where we are. And so our local group put on all sorts of different events and all kinds of different things. So this is sort of our last event for this year, and it's the first time that we've actually done an event for the 16 days of activism against violence against women. So that's a bit about our little group, and if anyone wants any information, you know, let me know. We also, at Amnesty, we have a policy that we have zero tolerance of anybody who might be saying, you know, racist comments or making comments that would be upsetting and things like that. So that's part of what this is. So I'll just, I know pretty much everybody here, and I know that that won't be an issue, but we just have now a zero tolerance of anyone who would make those sorts of comments, and we want this to be a safe space. I will also put in the chat function the phone number for 1-800-RESPECT if anybody feels that they need to have a break. Please feel free. This will be a discussion that will have some confronting issues, and we just want everybody to feel safe. So if you need to call 1-800-RESPECT or anything like that, or if you feel that there are some things that you might be feeling really uncomfortable with, please feel free to have a bit of a break. So I think that was all I needed to remember to say, hopefully. This will be recorded as well, and Mira is going to put it on her YouTube channel, so, and she'll do a bit of editing, and so that'll be very exciting. So I'm really pleased that this conversation will get out to so many other people, and Amnesty will share that as well. So that's fantastic. So I thought we might start with a question. I've sort of got a few themes that I thought would be really interesting. I've read this book. I thought it was amazing. It's incredibly well written, and it's got so many different things in there. And I was just saying to Amani before, one of the things I really enjoyed was her descriptions of visiting Lebanon when she was a child, and all the fun things she used to do with cousins, and how she described what the land looked like, and the village, and all of those things. And it felt like I was there as well. And so that was one of the things I really liked about the book, was how it was painting such a picture for me. But so the first thing I'd like to ask, what significance does the title, The Mother Wound, have for you? And why did you decide on that title?
Yeah, so The Mother Wound was a concept that I came across a few years ago. It's an idea in popular psychology that poses that women are affected by patriarchy, traumatized by patriarchy, and then they might project that trauma and the unhealed parts of that experience onto their children, and that contributes to cycles of intergenerational trauma. But at the time that I came across it, I was developing an art exhibition, and it was one of my first few solo shows, and I thought, okay, I think I'm going to run with that as the title of this show, because I was looking at the resilience that I gained from my grandmother and my mum, and reflecting on this idea of a mother wound and to what extent I was responsible for healing that for the next generation, and to what extent the issues were beyond me or structural. So the wounds that I ended up writing about are really both the literal harm that women suffer to their body, but also figuratively the way that people are displaced across the world, the ways in which systems and structures around us contribute to that harm and that wounding, and really posing a lot of questions around that I might not even know the answer to. So it was the perfect title, I think, for an examination of all of that harm and where it puts me today, and what kind of healing process I embark on.
Great, thank you. Because, yes, from that title, you could get so many different things if you didn't know what the book was about. So I found that really a really powerful title. So in the book, you discuss feminism and women of colour, and you ask yourself in the book, what can contemporary feminism do for me? So what are your thoughts on that idea?
Yeah, so one of the biggest things over the past few years for me doing feminist work and finding feminist allies and working as part of feminist organizations has been really examining the types of feminism that I learned about as I was growing up and the extent to which they were able to empower me or not. And I think for a lot of women of color, growing up in my generation in Australia, feminism was inaccessible. It was very much mainstream white feminism. And this language of intersectionality that has just become popular, thank you to the internet and to the work of lots of scholars who have been working on this for years, but I don't think it's ever reached the mainstream in the way that it has now. We can begin to appreciate how complex women's lives might actually be, and that we navigate multiple layers of injustice, and that the various parts of our identities are overlaid in such a way that that one injustice can be compounded by multiple different things. So I guess what I really wanted to look at was, back in my formative years as a high school, what did I actually learn that benefited me in terms of applying a lens to my life or to the experiences of people around me in order to understand the ways in which gender had been weaponized against them or had caused vulnerability or had not been accommodated for? And then what kind of feminism do I want to practice moving forward? And what kind of feminism can we build that is inclusive and life-saving and welcoming to people who have previously been skeptical? And one of the really big issues that I think is really important to note in this conversation is that for a lot of communities, feminism is associated with colonization and the ways in which their communities or their countries were subjected to colonial violence, challenged in terms of the treatment of their women being used as an excuse for invasions, or the language of women's rights being used as a tool for interfering in local customs or practices in a way that wasn't authentic to what those people were seeking and wasn't actually ultimately beneficial for the women. So I think that's really important to note. Not everybody has to identify as a feminist to make powerful change within their communities, and I respect that as well. And I think having these conversations has also allowed me to hopefully carve out a space in which other women feel safer contributing to conversations around violence against women in Australia or broadly. Because I think sometimes if you felt historically excluded by something or historically oppressed by something, it can be really difficult to raise your voice within a conversation and advocate for the needs of women who look like you or from the same cultural background as you, and the particular issues and barriers that they face.
So sort of expanding on that, over the time that you might sort of think of yourself perhaps as an activist, have you seen much of a shift, or is there still a really long way to go of hearing other voices, the non-Anglo voices as far as feminism?
I think it's a bit of both. I think that social media has created a space in which a lot of women and communities can actually build their own safe spaces and discuss really complex issues in relation to gender and other factors within their identities without that this external gaze all the time. It's also allowed people to access information more readily, share it with others, read the opinions and experiences of other women, and find people to relate to. So I think that's really empowering and useful. And I know that that's how I began to find different ways of being a feminist and different ways of relating to feminism and different, even developing my language, which is an ongoing process, my language around gender-based violence and understanding it from different other women's perspectives and looking at things through the lens of disabled activists, for example, or women of color from other communities or Indigenous women's perspectives. So I think that's been a tool that I've been able to benefit from in terms of sharing my own story, but also understanding the needs and intersecting barriers that other women face. So I think that's really valuable. But at the same time, the barriers that have stood in the way of women speaking out persist. So we have, and that includes everything. That includes a fear of backlash because you're expressing views as a woman in public. It can be a fear of backlash because you're expressing views as a visibly Muslim woman in public. Then there are the additional barriers that are a little bit harder to see. They might be in relation to accessing opportunities to share your story in the first place, having the language and the literacy needed to advocate for yourself or for your community, having the funding that's needed to create services so that you can build capacity among the women who you serve or you advocate for. So all these multiple layers, I think, are very much built into the structures and systems within our society and need to continue to be broken down before everybody feels that they can equally contribute. And the value of that contribution, I think, needs to be recognized, because through lived expertise, organizations are now finding that that's where you get the most valuable data, that's where you get the most persuasive stories, and that's how you're able to link the personal with the political and make better policy. I think there are now ministers within the government who are starting to appreciate the importance of consulting with victim survivors. There are victim survivors who found each other, and we've created collectives where we consult with people who are making decisions. So it's representative of our lived experience, and we can identify gaps that other people perhaps might not have even thought about.
Fantastic, thank you. So following on from that, my next question was, you also discuss intersectionality, and you've touched on that, as a survivor of family violence. So being a mother, a Muslim Arab woman from an immigrant background, you're also a trained lawyer, so obviously educated. So how do you think, with all of those things intersecting, and we talk a lot about intersectionality within sort of human rights space. So Amnesty are an organisation that work with Indigenous organisations. We're not an Indigenous organisation, so we don't speak on their behalf, but we've learned so much about how different communities intersect and people intersect. So how do you sort of navigate all of those things, or is it sometimes just so complex that, you know?
There was a period of time where things did seem so complex that I wasn't sure that I would ever, share my story. It's a big decision to make, I think, to make yourself vulnerable and to give the public that level of access to your life. But I think after I began to find allies and understand the scope of the problem and how important it was to contribute my experience to some of the conversations that were already happening, that fear kind of receded a little bit, and I was able to work through it. And I guess one of the most important barriers that I had to immediately confront was the fact that as a Muslim woman, having grown up post 9/11 and witnessed racism in different forms in my world, how do I speak out and navigate the inevitable, you know, negative media framing, stereotyping, backlash, and things like that, that women who look like me have experienced in the past. And it was a matter of actually building up, to an extent, my confidence in relation to writing and speaking about race. That was a, you know, something that you don't learn at school. And I didn't feel that I had the skills to directly challenge any sort of backlash. So it was about waiting until I'd read and learned about how to feel empowered within those conversations that I was then able to start writing about my experiences and give them language. So that was one hurdle that I faced. But as a mother, I was 5 months pregnant when I lost my mum to DV, and there was the legal system to navigate, and then there was motherhood to navigate at the same time. And whilst I had the privilege and the literacy and the ability to advocate for myself within our legal and political systems, which served me, and despite that, my dad's trial was still the most confronting and re-traumatizing thing I've ever been through. That was an advantage, and at the same time, I found motherhood utterly overwhelming, and I found that there were so many barriers that mums face in terms of financial security, in terms of looking after their emotional well-being, healing from trauma, accessing the help that they need, and even just carrying all of this information that I was still processing at the time and trying to look after myself while looking after a baby was really difficult. And then added to that were the some of the structural barriers. So one of the examples that I've been talking about recently is in relation to the paid parental leave scheme. After my daughter was born, I found out that I was no longer eligible for paid parental leave because I'd taken too much time off work after losing my mum. During that period, I had moved my sisters into my home. They were dependent on her. They were uni students. I had undertaken counselling. I had to, you know, correspond with the Crown Solicitor's Office about what was happening with the trial. I was pregnant. There were appointments. There was so much to do. I couldn't imagine returning to 9-to-5 work as a commercial litigator and focusing on other people's problems during that period. So with my employer and with Centrelink actually informed, I decided that I would run my leave into my parental leave. And then they said to me, oh, you've fallen 5 days outside of the work test and you're no longer eligible. And they said that retrospectively. So the baby was already born at this point. And that was, to me, really confronting as an example of a barrier that fails to accommodate how complex our lives are and the types of things that a person might go through during a pregnancy. And I thought, I can't possibly be the first person who's had their life turned upside down for a reason that doesn't fit within the existing exemptions. And the existing exemptions at the time were either a pregnancy-related illness had caused you to take time off work, or you'd had a premature birth. I didn't fit in either of those boxes. So my decision was to write a letter to the minister at the time, involve my local member of parliament, and long story short, I was able to get an outcome for myself where they squeezed me into one of those boxes artificially. And I thought, that's not good enough. The point isn't that I should get paid parental leave. The point is that anyone in my situation should get paid parental leave. So I brought that up when I first had the opportunity to speak publicly, and my local member was there, and then he took that to parliament. And after years of bringing it up in different forums, the law was finally changed in September to close that gap. And I think that's a really powerful example of those structural barriers. Someone who wasn't aware, for example, of how to navigate those laws, or how to advocate for themselves, or who didn't have the literacy or the time or the ability or even the emotional labor that it takes, is really difficult. So would have just given up. So I think it's really important that we continuously identify those sorts of gaps and change the laws that we need to change in order to make sure people are not left vulnerable at a time where they're already very vulnerable.
Yeah. Well, thank you. I think anyone who's been a mother knows how busy, even with all the support in the world, how busy all of that can be. And, you know, then you're trying to perhaps work or, you know, do volunteer work and just be part of a community. It's, yeah, there's so much going on. So, you know, my hat is taken off to you because you sat and wrote a book as well and all these various things. I mean, you know. One of the things I was thinking about, and you discuss in your book about being not a good kind of victim, which is a really interesting phrase. I wonder if you could expand on that and what being not a good victim means to you.
Yeah. So one of the things that I learned through my experience of victimhood, and I think it's important to mention as well that some people, I now identify or I'm often identified as a victim survivor, but the survivor word at one, you know, until a few, maybe 2 years ago, I'd not even thought of myself as having survived anything. I just thought of myself as having been victimized over and over again by my experience, my grief, the barriers that I was facing. And I would get a little bit irritated the first few times I heard the word survivor, because I thought, no, there's nothing inspiring or wonderful about this. This is preventable, and violence is a deliberate act that's been inflicted on people, and I've been victimized by it, and I'm very comfortable with that word despite the stigma that it carries to be a victim. I think that stigma needs to be challenged. Victims are not weak. They're not without their agency. My mum was a very tough, resilient person who raised four children despite the barriers that she had, who accessed an education and who was getting a degree at the time of her death. And she would have been the first in her family to graduate from university. She had her own home. She had an independent income. And despite all of that, she still faced violence. So I think it's important to shift away from the assumption that sometimes exists out there and in popular culture that victims are these, sorry, someone in my neighborhood is setting off fireworks for some reason right now. So did not plan for that, but they should stop soon. So I think it's really important to challenge the idea that women who've been victimized by violence or by abuse are meek or subservient or somehow without any agency and passive and require someone to sweep in and save them. They're usually exercising a lot of intelligence and investing a lot of emotional energy into planning and working out what's going to be best for them, what's going to be best for their children, how they're going to, you know, build a life that works for them. So that's one aspect of it. In relation to the pressure that I felt to perform a type of victimhood that people could relate to or empathize with, that came from sort of two different directions. The first is the one that I touched on, which is in relation to the structural issues and the assumptions and the stereotypes that might be projected onto me. But then the other one was within my family and within my particular extended family and community. So there were people who were siding with my dad, supporting my dad, endorsing or justifying his behavior in different ways to save face or to basically save themselves from the embarrassment of having a criminal family member and the shame that's attached to that. So there was that part, and the pressure that came from them was that as the eldest daughter, as the daughter who has an education or the ability, they perceive me as having the ability to help somehow, and that I should do the right thing by them and by him and be forgiving and be part of that collective. And I found that repugnant, and it goes without saying. And yet there were people around me who thought that that was a normal or reasonable expectation to have. And how difficult is it to speak out about that as a Muslim woman, and to speak out about the way that you've experienced patriarchy when you also know that you're going to experience a lot of stereotyping around that too. So that was a tricky thing to navigate. But then when I started reading the literature around victims and victimization, I found so much validation in what researchers have identified before around victim blaming and why it happens and the psychological drivers of that. And basically people find it uncomfortable to acknowledge the pain of a victim, to sit with the grief, and to sit with the fact that sometimes things happen to us that we do not deserve and cannot control. And that makes people uncomfortable. And when you demand from them that they do something and not be a bystander or challenge their own deeply ingrained beliefs about something, that again makes them uncomfortable. So psychologically, it can be easier for a lot of people to blame you for your own circumstances, to detach from you, to find a way to not relate to you, to withdraw that compassion. So I think that's a really empowering bit of knowledge to come across. And I continued to read what victimologists had said and what they were saying around victims of crime and women in particular, in order to inform myself about why this was happening and why people were leaning so heavily into victim blaming narratives around me. And it's important to also connect that with the law, because the law itself in Australia, until recently in New South Wales, had a provocation defence where you quite literally blamed the victim for a homicide as a defence in court. And that was a perfectly valid way of reducing your culpability. So understanding where that comes from has been really empowering. And I think it's really important that we challenge that within ourselves, and that when we see a news story where we have an inclination or an unconscious bias against the victim, to question where that's coming from and really think about, okay, why am I setting out to put the responsibility and the shame on this individual when really it should be over there?
So my next question sort of follows on from there. So you discussed the concept of forgiveness, and there were many, many people in your life demanded that you forgive your father for his crimes. What are your sort of thoughts on this? I'm assuming that your thoughts on that have probably evolved over time. But yes, this concept of forgiveness.
Yeah, so I started reflecting on this really early on in the piece. The first time someone suggested to me that that was a way to behave, I thought, no, that doesn't seem right. It doesn't fit within my value system. It doesn't fit within things that I've learned. It doesn't even make sense to me within my faith. It doesn't make sense to me as a lawyer. It doesn't make sense to me as anyone with a human rights perspective. So why is it so popular? Why is it such a popular narrative? Why do people love to see a forgiveness story? And how do I explain the fact that I'm really comfortable not forgiving this behavior? And how do I make it so that I'm not justifying that decision for anyone? And when I was doing my, I'm still doing my master's, but at the time I was doing my master's thesis within my master's of Islamic studies, and I decided that I would make that my thesis question, because if I was going to read about it, I may as well do the work. And I came across this idea that exists across all of the Abrahamic faiths, which is this valuing of forgiveness as the morally right thing to do. But in particular, in a lot of Christian traditions, there were some groups that actually put forgiveness as the uppermost priority, to the point where not to forgive a sin was worse than the sin itself. And that put women at a huge disadvantage, because they would be reluctant to testify in court, because that would not be the gracious thing to do. They would not report crime, because it was their duty to be forgiving. And putting that pressure on people who have been victimized is incredibly unfair. And what it does is weaponize their faith, which is something that might be really important to them. It might be a coping mechanism that they're using at the time, weaponizing it in order to manipulate their behavior. And it's utterly inappropriate, because we know that people need validation in order to start healing from trauma. They need not to be blamed for their trauma, and they need to hear people I guess, condemning the behavior that they've been subjected to in order to feel that, you know what, I'm going to get some closure, or this is not okay and it's not just me who feels that way. So it was really important to investigate that and to challenge the idea that the automatic thing that we do to be nice people or good people is to forgive. I think there are lots of other priorities that are important, and accountability is absolutely one of them.
Great, thank you. I probably have a similar view to forgiveness. So in your book, you say we need to do more than just talk about ending violence against women. What would you like us to know, and what can we do to affect change?
Okay, so the answer to this continuously changes for me, but there are some things that I've been talking about this year at my 16 days of activism events that I think are current issues that people are speaking about. I think the overarching theme is that governments need to invest money into the services that do this work. I'm on the board of the Bankstown Women's Health Centre. There are about 20 women's health centres in our state. They're incredibly underfunded, but they do the most valuable work. And a lot of women turn up to these services in order to just find a safe space to sit and rest, in order to access counselling, or even to access things like nutrition advice or a GP or legal advice. And through the process of accessing those services, they might make disclosures about current or past abuse. And that means that a lot of the work that the service does incidentally to the things that it offers is related to DV or experiences of child sexual assault. So I think having a healthy, safe community means making sure that organizations have the resources that they need in order to meet the demand. And they don't meet the demand. They're always busy. They're stretched to capacity. And we've seen now, because of COVID, how important it is that that infrastructure is really stable before a pandemic or some other type of crisis strikes. And I know that at our center, staff had to be redeployed to do the most basic things, which included dropping off food to families who are in isolation, calling women who are isolated or have language barriers or don't have visas to just check in on them. And that meant that the work that they'd been doing before, already at capacity, was even more reduced to just meeting essential need. So that's one thing. I think, you know, you guys can't do that, but I think we need to be agitating for dollars, not just inspiring remarks from our leaders. I think another really important thing that I've seen, a campaign that's running at the moment actually, is for the establishment of a specialized trauma center for women in Wollongong. The Illawarra Women's Health Centre is currently running that campaign, and they're basically trying to create a space where women can go and have their trauma treated in a space that's designed specifically for that purpose, with people who work there that specifically understand abuse and DV and the way that that creates trauma. So that's one of the things that people can go out and support just by signing the petition or supporting the campaign. I'm an ambassador for the women's community shelters, which are also in New South Wales, and they set up partnerships with local communities and establish crisis accommodation for women and their children. And the reason that's so important is that we know that there's a housing shortage all across Australia. For women to wait for safe accommodation puts them at further risk. A lot of the time it's financial issues and housing issues that cause women to think twice about leaving an abuser, because it's really difficult to relocate your children. It's really difficult to live out of a motel for 4 weeks without any certainty about the future. And I think we need things like universal childcare. And I know that sounds like a big ask, but in a country as wealthy as ours, that should be a given. And that is key to allowing women to participate fully and equally in the workforce. It also creates safety, because when you're accessing counselling or safety planning or casework or a lawyer through your DV proceedings, you need somewhere to leave your children. And it's just incredibly difficult for women to do the things that they need to do to establish a new life for themselves after leaving abuse whilst caring for small children. So I think that's one of the biggest barriers that's out there and one that we don't speak out about enough.
Fantastic. I've got one last question and then we'll open it up for others to ask. You were shortlisted for the Archibald Prize for your painting. How has art helped you heal your trauma?
I think art has been probably one of the most important tools in my healing toolkit. One of the things that I touch on in the book is the fact that it takes a while for our brain to begin processing traumatic experience into language, and art can actually help bridge that gap. So sometimes when you don't have the words for your experience yet, or you don't have the coherence to describe what you've been through or how you're feeling, art can provide an outlet that is accessible, it's immediate, anyone can tap into it. And it was something that I'd loved all throughout my childhood and all throughout school anyway. And it was a hobby at the time. And it's become a lot more than that, because I was able to rely on making art as a way of having me time. It was a form of self-care. And gradually I was able to start using it to express things that I hadn't been able to express at all. And throughout the period of my dad's trial, I was making art at home. It was for me only. And then I had this idea of this painting where I would be holding a picture of my mum, holding a picture of her mum. And it was sort of bubbling away in the back of my mind, but I didn't feel qualified as an artist because I'm self-taught. I didn't feel qualified to submit it or draw any kind of attention to this idea. And eventually I worked through that and I thought, you know what, you've got nothing to lose. It's open to the public. Just paint the painting and do it. And I think that was really pivotal for me, because up until that point, I hadn't spoken with the media about my experiences. I hadn't felt safe engaging the public in any capacity. And art gave me a safe space, and it gave me a way of inviting the public into a dialogue with me that felt right for me at the time. And so many people visit the Archibald Prize, and I didn't have to be there sharing my story in the flesh, but they could meet me and meet my mum and meet my grandmother through that one image. And I think that's pretty powerful. And I'm really privileged now to be able to have a creative practice and to make art and to, I think, share stories through that medium, because sometimes it's the most powerful way to get a story across.
Fantastic. Thank you. If anyone has any questions, can you please put them in the chat and we will ask them. People typing away. Okay, so from Jenny, can you comment on the need to teach our boys about issues of patriarchy, gender violence, and gender equality? Yes, I know. Yeah, exactly what you where you're going there, Jenny.
Yeah, I think it's essential. I think learning about equality shouldn't be this artificial thing that you do as an adult. I mean, if you're already an adult, that's how you've got to do it. But I know with my own children, I raise them to be aware of the importance of treating others fairly. And that's the beginning of their journey of understanding gender equality. I think one of the things that I try to challenge is if they come home from school with a stereotype or a gender role or something that they've picked up from someone, I try to challenge that. I would say, well, why do you think that that toy is only for girls? Or why do you think that that job is only for girls? So I think you can have those conversations with boys as children. I don't think there's anything, I think that's really empowering, and it allows you to model different ways of being a man and what a healthy relationship looks like and things like that. I think unfortunately because of a lot of the conversation being focused on what women do and what they do to leave abuse and then what they do afterwards and what they need, and that's really important, but a lot of the time not enough resources are put into that preventative work. And I've been into schools where young teenage girls think things that are actually red flags for emotional and psychological abuse are very romantic, and that's because young people are absorbing all kinds of messaging from popular culture that are really harmful and are not really what a healthy relationship looks like at all. And they need to hear views that challenge that. There's a local initiative that is really great in my area, that's the Canterbury Bankstown area, where they've engaged local primary schools and used creative arts, particularly music and rap, to get young boys to rap and perform about gender equality. And it's very cute. You go along to these events and they do their performances on significant days, and the community can sort of see how that messaging is being totally normalized for them and how they're receiving that more healthy masculinity through that work. So I think there needs to be a lot more of that. I think there are some promising projects happening, but I think we need, I haven't heard of any specific funding being allocated for like statewide or national programs that do that work.
Thank you. Does anybody else have a question they would like to ask?
My sisters are good.
Okay. Yes, how are your sisters?
That's so sweet. Thank you for asking. My youngest sister, Ola, has had obviously a very difficult journey as a direct witness to my dad's violence on the evening of the murder. But she has recently, at the beginning of the year, she graduated from her uni degree. So she actually finished it, which is fantastic. And she also got married earlier in the year, and she's now pregnant. So, so lots happening for her. And Noor is a reporter at Parliament in Canberra that sometimes graces our TV screens with the news. And she loves her job, so she's very happy too.
And what channel would she normally be reporting for?
ABC.
Oh, good.
Yeah, yeah. So she's the federal politics. Yeah, she's their federal politics reporter at Parliament.
Yeah. Oh. Anybody have any questions they would like to ask? Would it be quicker if people just raised their hands? Would that be easier for everybody?
That's fine. I'm comfortable with that.
Yeah. So if anybody would just raise your hand, might be quicker. Jenny, you're on mute, Jen.
You're muted.
Okay.
There we go.
Do you feel as though you've got the support of the Lebanese community where you live, that once they've seen the trial and there was that reaction from your dad's part of the family and you've published the book, do you feel as though you've got more support from you know, that part of the community?
Yeah, so it was interesting. At the time, it was never a black and white thing. So there were people who were supportive, but in a very passive way, not knowing what to say, not knowing how to navigate the fact that we're all from the one community and feeling conflicted, you know, which I personally don't relate to, but some people felt that way. But I think now, well, I've always had the support of my mum's family, her relatives who live overseas, who I guess depend on me to speak out about what's happened for their own sense of justice, and they follow everything I do on social media. It's very sweet that they support that work. And some of the biggest champions of my work have been other Muslim women who relate and have stories of their own and are really proud to be involved in the conversation, or really proud to be able to relate to this work or to see it being well received. And I think that's really important. So whilst it was sad and frustrating to lose the support of my father's family and to become estranged from people who I grew up around, I think overwhelmingly there were people who were either quiet in their support or who have now come out and actually messaged me and said, I didn't know what to say at the time, but I want you to know that I relate to the things that you've written. I've just never heard anyone speak about it publicly. I didn't know what to say. In fact, you know, my mum has had this experience, or I've had this experience. And I think that's what I mean by carving out a space where people feel safer, speaking out about their experiences. And hopefully that'll translate in the future to, you know, not just me having this conversation, but, and I'm not the only one, but other women feeling more comfortable contributing.
Thanks, Amani.
Yeah. We've got another question from Mira. Just can you comment on how stories like yours can be made more easily available in school and university curriculum?
Yeah, so I've gone into a couple of schools to present here and there in my local area. I also lecture as a guest lecturer at Western Sydney University in their family violence subject. And I've also recently been having more internal conversations with university staff about responding to disclosures and appropriately responding if a student, for example, has had an experience of DV or is navigating abuse and how to respond to that. So I think it's taken a long time for these conversations to happen in those spaces, but I think as time goes by and people read the book or engage with it in different ways, I think there'll be more of that. I've recently been involved in an initiative called Future Leaders, where groups of teenagers are being trained and provided with the skills to advocate for gender equality, and that includes boys and girls. And speaking to them was incredible because they were so involved and they had a level of literacy and awareness that we didn't have when I was at school, that's for sure. And they were really dedicated to conveying what they were learning to their own cohorts and their school communities. I'm also aware that my book has been put on a couple of subject reading recommended reading lists in one of the universities that I've worked alongside. But I think it is important to have diverse voices in literature more broadly, but to have that also infiltrate school curriculums, because I loved English at school. I've obviously enjoyed literature for a long time and have loved writing. But the stories that I grew up reading, like Jane Eyre and the other classics, were powerful, but they weren't reflective of the issues or the lived experiences that I was navigating in real time. So I think having making stories accessible in schools in a way that is more relevant to people's lives is really empowering for communities.
Amnesty International Australia are putting together some resources, so we've got somebody who's going to be helping us, and I'm sort of helping with that project as well, but human rights resources for schools. So we've actually employed somebody to help us work on this. And yeah, so that's going to be a big part of our website and different things like that. So all sorts of human rights, so women's rights, refugee rights, all different things that the general public or teachers can, you know, download and use as part of the curriculum. And one of our hopes, one of the things that we're pushing for, is for human rights to become embedded in national curriculum. So that's one of the things that we're kind of working on behind the scenes type of thing, because we view it, and I'm sure everybody here does, that it's so incredibly important that young people know what human rights are and how to be very active in advocating, because once you get all of that knowledge, those generations then come through and that sort of thing. It's so important. We've got a couple of minutes left. Has anybody got any last questions?
Oh, there's a question there about whether my art will be exhibited in Melbourne.
Sorry.
And I'm excited to answer that question. So yes, I have an exhibition starting at Schoolhouse Studios, which is an artist-run space, in the end of March. If you follow me on social media, you'll see me share the details of that. I recently had one at Mars Gallery, and I'm having hopefully another one there later next year, but that's still under wraps, so don't tell anyone I told you. but Schoolhouse Studios in March, and hopefully some more down the track. And the last one I had was at the time that my book was launched, and that was fantastic, and I was so excited to bring my art to Melbourne because it was my first time. It was my first commercial exhibition as well. So that was very cool. And I didn't get to travel down, unfortunately, because of the pandemic and the very necessary restrictions around that. So I'm hoping this time I'll actually get to be there and do some cool public programming.
That would be, I'm sure we'd all be very excited. I'm incredibly impressed by your art. I have no talent for drawing, or even though my mum was an art teacher, I have no talent myself at all. So I'm always impressed by people, particularly people who haven't been to university, like yourself, taught. And it's just so it speaks such a lot, your art. So but I'm also very impressed because I can't do it, so
thank you. It's a lot of work.
Oh yes, I'm sure. But yes. We might
did you draw the cover?
Oh yes,
of the book?
Not the cover, no. The cover was designed by a book designer, Akiko Chen. And she, I think she did a beautiful job. It took my breath away, so it was perfect. Yeah. But my painting, the 2018 Archibald painting, is in the back, inside cover.
So beautiful.
Yeah. Thank you.
I've seen that at the end of the
story. Oh, yes, you can see it. Mira's got it there. Yeah.
Amani, was that at Tarawarra Gallery or Geelong Gallery?
Geelong.
I saw it. Yeah. I knew that I'd seen it in my when I went to the exhibition at one point.
Thank you.
Amazing. The idea and concept behind it was just fabulous.
It's just, what a beautiful piece to have in your family history forever. Like, it's just beautiful.
Thank you.
Well, we might finish up there with 1 minute to go. So I think done pretty good timekeeping, because usually often these conversations, like, we could just talk for hours, I'm sure, but Amani has small children to attend and things like that. But I'd like to say, on behalf of everybody here, including Mira from the Eltham Bookshop and our little Amnesty group, and Carol's joined us from Amnesty in Newcastle, and Jody, thank you so much for being part of this event with us. I was saying before, it's so important that we hear a diverse range of voices, and Amnesty are trying really hard to be able to bring forward and that sort of thing, because, you know, often we might have Julian Burnside come to a, you know, to an event, and that's great, but he's a privileged white man, middle-aged man, and, you know, we do need to hear other voices. Julian Burnside is great, but you know, we are making a particular effort now to be able to hear diverse voices. And if anybody doesn't have the book, Mira has copies at the Eltham Bookshop. If anybody doesn't already have a copy, and let your friends know, because I've just finished reading it and I was astounded. And people who know me, I read about a book a week. So, and I just thought this was an amazing piece of writing, and Amani's obviously very talented in lots of different ways.
Thank you.
So, thank you so much.
So, my copy arrived today. Thank you, Mira. My copy of the book.
It's wonderful that people are reading. Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it.
Fabulous talk. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm just going to share in the chat. Hopefully I can. See. Can I do it or not?
Do you want me to paste it in from my end?
Yes. Yep. Yes. I'm not very good at technological things, but just the number for 1-800-RESPECT.
Yeah. And just so people know, that's not just for people who are experiencing abuse. It's also if you're concerned about someone else or you just want to get some advice for a neighbor or help someone, they can help in that way as well. I think it's a valuable resource and something that you can tap into anytime.
Right. And thank you so much. And if you want information on Amnesty's work that we do on women's rights, you just go to amnesty.org.au. And click on the women's rights section. There's so many different things there as well, petitions and various things. So thank you so much for coming along. And thank you to everybody. And thank you to Mira, who helped organise this event. Yes. And, yeah, it's the last sort of big event that we're doing for our group for this year, but hopefully we'll have lots more events next year. And I will just say good night and thank you so much for coming.
Thanks, Mom.
Good night, everyone. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Take care.
Thank you.
Good night, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good night.
Good night.